High school, how are we doing tonight? Let's go. Well, hey, we're so glad that you guys are here. We are in week two of our series called Controversial Jesus. And so we're talking about Jesus and some of his controversial thoughts. And so we're diving into week two. But last week, Pastor Landon kicked it off for us. First, can we celebrate? We saw 8 students give their lives to Jesus last week. Here at midweek, we're so excited about that. But really, his whole message was about the idea that controversial, or let me get it. Where are we at? Yeah, controversial is costly. And the idea behind that is, hey, if you want to live for Jesus, it's going to be controversial. And if you want to live for Jesus, it's more than likely, actually guaranteed, like promised by Jesus, that it is going to cost you something. It may be different from one person to the next. It may be relationships. It may be your life. But it's going to cost you something. And so we kicked off this series, and really that idea is going to be a thread that runs through every message in this series. But tonight what we want to do is we want to take a second and talk about this topic, safety and violence. Safety and violence, and I think this is a very timely and important thing to talk about this week, but I wanted to invite my wife, Haley, to join us tonight for a few reasons. One, she's the goat. Two, she is better at me at stuff like this, better than me at stuff like this. See, she's a better communicator. And number three, I think that she has a lot to bring to a conversation like this. So, Haley, why don't you introduce yourself and just share what you do.
Yes, so I'm Haley Fletcher. I'm Alex's wife, but I also have my master's in clinical mental health counseling, and so I work as a counselor, and something that I specialize in, what I'm trained to do, is work with children who have experienced abuse or trauma in their life. So I work with kids from the ages of 3 to 18 who have experienced various types of trauma in their life. And so I'm trained to do that, and I am just really excited and honored to get to be a part of this conversation, because we know that there are some of you here in this room or people that you love that have been victims of abuse and violence in their life. And so I'm just really grateful to be a part of this conversation with you guys.
Yeah. Awesome. Well, As we get started tonight, this has been on our calendar, on our schedule for a while now. But many of you know what happened just this week with the shooting in Nashville at a school, and brings up a lot of different emotions for people, and a lot of fear probably for those of you that go to school every single day. And so we kind of wanted to have this conversation, and we want to start the conversation tonight by just lifting up some prayer and just asking that God would help those who are directly affected, the families that are devastated, but also the kids that now have to go back to school. And honestly, we want to pray for you guys that you know, that you're able to deal and process and overcome some of the fear maybe that you're feeling from this. So let's pray, and then we'll jump in tonight. Father God, we ask that you have mercy. God, would you somehow provide peace to the families who were involved, who lost children, who lost loved ones? And God, I pray that you would bring healing with time. And God, I ask that you would let your presence be known to them. God, that you would maybe be able to give them wisdom, and Lord, we ask that you give them strength. God, I pray for the students that are in this room that may be experiencing fear in light of things like this that happen, and those that may be experiencing anxiety, and Lord, we pray against those things, and we ask that God, as we turn to your word here tonight, that you would would speak to us about the idea of violence and safety, and God, what you've called us to do and how you've called us to live and respond. And so, God, we love you and we trust you even when we don't understand the things that happen around us. Pray all these things in Jesus' name. Amen. So as we were preparing for this series, one of the things that I find really interesting is when you begin to look at the difference between generations. When I say generations, I'm talking about millennials, baby boomers, Gen Z. That's kind of what I'm referring to. And I think it's really interesting when you begin to look at the things that matter to each generation and things that really define each generation. And when you begin to study that and you begin to look over the course of history, what you'll see are there are some key moments that define every single generation. These moments in history that happen, and they completely change the way that a generation of people view life and the way that they live their lives and the way that they pursue happiness and things like safety. And so I want us to kind of look at, by generation, what are some of these pivotal, key, defining moments in generations. So you have the silent generation. This is anyone born from 1928 to 1945. And my goodness, they would be extremely old. But World War II was for them probably the most defining moment for their generation, the impact that had on them financially, their loved ones who were actually in war. Obviously, the world being at war is going to be a major moment. So for silent generation, it was World War II. For the next generation, the baby boomers, these are people who were born 1946 to 1964. Things like the civil rights movement, things like the JFK assassination, and the moon landing were very impactful things for this generation. Let's keep going. Gen X, these are people born 1965 to 1980. You have the end of the Cold War. You have the AIDS crisis. That was kind of a global crisis. And then you have, this one's kind of weird, and then I think it's interesting, the start of MTV. Like, music videos on TV literally shaped a generation of people, along with AIDS and the end of the Cold War. So I think that's really interesting. Any Gen X people in here, small group leaders, who we got? Let's go. You guys shaped by these things, yes? No? MTV. I knew David Anderson liked some MTV back in the day. Okay, so what? We skipped the boomers? Is boomers not in? Oh, where are the boomers at? Let's go, Ramona. Come on. Yes. I typically try to stay away I put the year that these people were born and past a certain age. I tend to not highlight. That's right, dog. You be proud of that, bro. I love that. Millennials. This is me. Any millennials in here? Yeah, let's go. Millennials, 1981 to 1996, the 9/11 attacks, the Obama election, and Hurricane Katrina were some of the most impactful moments on this generation. And so now when we get to what's known as Gen Z, and they're starting to make some generational divides in there, but for now, we're going to talk about anyone born after 1996, which is all of you guys in the room. I'm considering you part of Gen Z. There's some things that obviously have shaped your generation, things like social media. You guys have not been alive, right, where the iPhone wasn't invented, or was it just social media? I don't know. Internet, I don't know. You guys have not been alive without these things. You guys haven't grown up without these things. It's impacted you, the technology there. And then obviously we know that COVID-19, we don't know to what extent that COVID-19 has affected your generation, but obviously it's affected all of us who have lived through it. But then there was another one that I find very interesting in my research that's really not one event, it's a series of events, and it's this exposure to violence. Exposure to violence is one of the key things that's listed. Multiple sources, I've researched this, multiple sources say that Gen Z, one of the things that defines you as a generation is your exposure to violence. You're one of the few generations that has never, that as long as you've been alive, we've been at war. You haven't been alive where we haven't been in wartime, where there hasn't been a global threat of terror. And so I think that's really, really interesting. And so we want to lean into that tonight. We want to lean into this idea that this overexposure to violence is shaping your generation. And we actually, Haley and I, have gathered a lot of stats that I think apply to this idea. And So first, just in light of what we just experienced this week, okay, I want to share some gun violence statistics, okay? These are mind-blowing. Like, they've had me a little bit shook all week long, and so I want to share some of these with you. Monday morning in Nashville was the 19th shooting at a school or university this year in 2023. 19th. Since 1970, okay, that's 50 years. Since 1970, over the course of 50 years, there have been just over 2,000 school shootings. 2,000, okay? But in the last 10 years, since the Sandy Hook shooting, over half of those have taken place. So 2,000 in 50 years, and in the last 10 years, there's been over 1,000. It's unbelievable. There have been 130 mass shootings. That means that at least four people were injured or killed. There have been 130 mass shootings in the United States alone this year, 2023. There have been 57 people killed, 133 people injured in mass shootings this month alone, in the month of March. And so, we share all of that to say it's all around us. Like, this is not a isolated incident that we're mourning from Monday. Like this has been a common thing in your lifetime. And so we want to address it, and we want to talk about it tonight.
Yeah, and so those are kind of some stats on violence that we have seen kind of in the community, right? Community violence, globally, nationally. But we also know that there are many of you, like I said, in this room, or people that you love who have experienced violence personally in your life. And so we want to give a couple of statistics on abuse as well. And so when we talk about abuse, there are many different kinds of abuse. You've got physical abuse, sexual abuse, the witnessing of domestic violence, which would be violence between maybe parents in the home, and then also neglect or just maltreatment. And so first, domestic violence. So this is, like I said, when maybe you have parents or people at home who are abusing one another, who are injuring one another, and you are witnessing that. So 1 in 15 kids will witness domestic violence in the past year. So in a year, there's 1 in 15 who experience this. And then 1 in 5 kids or teenagers will witness domestic violence within their lifetime. So 1 in 5 are witnessers of domestic violence. And interestingly enough, we are seeing some information come out, new research that shows that when you witness violence, when you're witnessing domestic violence, you actually are showing the same symptoms as someone who has experienced the violence themselves. So we see the exact same symptoms, the exact same diagnoses, everything for a kid that maybe has experienced abuse themselves, the same thing with a kid who has witnessed that violence. And so even talking about all the violence that we're exposed to, that really does have an effect on you. And also talking about abuse, so one of the types of abuse that I mentioned was sexual abuse, and statistics are showing that 1 in 3 girls experience sex abuse by the time they're 18, and 1 in 5 boys experience sex abuse by the time that they're 18. And these are just the kids who have disclosed that this has happened. So this is just what we know. And for every kid who discloses abuse, there's probably 4 to 6 kids who have never told anybody and never maybe will tell anyone. And so also just a little caveat, boys are less likely to disclose. So we assume that that number is actually closer together. But boys are typically less likely to tell someone if they have been abused. And then this is a more recent stat, but it was 2019. So we're thinking pre-pandemic, and actually post-pandemic, we are seeing more and more disclosures of abuse because kids were left at home with the people who were abusing them. But in 2019, in the U.S. alone, there were 656,000 kids, victims found of abuse. And so to give you some perspective on that, that would be filling up Neyland Stadium 6.5 times, just with kids who in that year disclosed abuse. So.
So this is heavy stuff. We recognize that. And we also recognize that, like, no doubt this has an impact on an entire generation, right? Like, there's no doubt in our minds. And I think that there are other contributing factors to these next set of stats. But I think that the violence that we've been exposed to, all the things that we just listed, the things you see on social media, the videos that maybe you watched this week are contributing factors to this, that there's been a 145% increase in girls with major depression since 2010. That number is 161% for boys. So an increase in major depression, 145% in girls, 161% in boys since 2010. Suicides have increased 109% in boys ages 10 to 14 and 134% in girls since 2010. Ages 15 to 19, these are people who have been admitted to the hospital, okay? So they've been taken in, admitted to the hospital because of non-fatal self-harm, okay? Admitted to the hospital for non-fatal self-harm, 48% increase in girls, 37% increase in boys since 2010. And so like I said, I think there are other factors that contribute to stats like these, but I feel like this exposure to violence has to be a major contributing factor, and these stats are devastating, guys. Like, don't just skip past this. Don't let this be another thing that your mind scrolls past as if you're scrolling on Instagram. Like, feel the weight of this. This is devastating for a generation, for your generation. And I think that it makes it abundantly clear that we are overexposed to violence. We're overexposed to violence. We have access to it 24/7 on our phones. At any point, we can go look up videos from any of these major things from history that we've been talking about. At any point, we get access on the news and so many other outlets of all the negative things, all the violence that's happening around us. Some of you are exposed to it maybe in your homes. You need to reach out and tell somebody about that. Maybe you've just been hearing about it. Your friend is experiencing it. But regardless, we're overexposed to violence. And the temptation then is this. The temptation is that we overexalt safety. The temptation is that we put safety up on a pedestal and that we idolize it. And then that leaves us crippled by fear and we can't live our lives. So we're overexposed to violence, but the temptation is to overexalt safety. And I think what has happened is these phrases like this one, safe spaces, have dominated a generation. We just need to provide safe spaces that people can go and not feel like they're being judged. And hear me, okay, hear me, we're going to get into this. We are entitled to safety in our homes and schools, like, absolutely. Don't hear me wrong when I say this, but what we've done with saying things like we just need to provide safe spaces is what we've done is we've begun to idolize this idea of safety, and I just think that maybe there's a better response to the violence that we're experiencing.
Yeah, and so we want to clarify here, like Alex said, safety is not a bad thing. I am a counselor, and I talk about safety all the time. My girls can tell you one of my favorite words in my small group to use is boundaries. They always make fun of me for that. But Boundaries are important. Keeping yourself safe is important. You deserve to be safe at school. You deserve to feel safe at school. You deserve to be safe at home and to feel safe at home. So don't hear us when we're talking about this think that Jesus doesn't care if I'm safe. You deserve that type of safety. And also we need to be mindful to keep other people safe, right? With our actions, with our driving. We need to make sure that we try to stay safe.
We've seen you guys drive in this parking lot.
Yes. But some of you have seen me drive, so I don't have much room to talk. But
it's not on purpose, though.
Yeah, it's just because I'm bad.
A bad driver.
But anyways, so we care about safety. We want you to be safe and to have boundaries that keep you safe. But like Alex said, when we talk about safety for the remainder of this talk, we're really talking about comfort. A lot of times when people are hoping for safety or wanting safety, what they're really wanting is they want to be comfortable. And you don't necessarily deserve to be comfortable, right? You might be cold at school, or the seats are uncomfortable, or someone beside you might believe differently, and that makes you feel uncomfortable. And that's okay. And we aren't called to be comfortable.
Right, and I think what we do there is we begin to use the word safe in those situations, right, too. Like, I just don't feel safe with this person. No, you're just not comfortable around
right.
that person. And
right.
and so we begin to use this word in a way that's, like, not healthy, right?
Right. So just to clarify, as we move forward, we're really talking about comfort is not the goal. Not that you should not be safe. Like Alex said, if
totally.
You are at home and you are not safe in your home, you need to tell someone, and
yes.
you deserve to be safe. So,
absolutely. So really for us, our goal, the question that we're trying to answer or at least provide clarity on tonight is this: how do we live in a violent culture? Those stats prove it. We live in a violent culture, so the question is, how do we do that? How do we do that in a way that doesn't idolize safety or comfort, right? But honors God, and in a way that we can still live boldly. Like, what does that look like? And so, the first thing I think that we need to recognize is, like, this is not a 21st century problem. Like. We live in a violent culture, but we're not the only generation in the past to live in a violent culture. When you look at the Bible, literally it took one generation of people for there to be a murder. You had Adam and Eve, all right, first people born. Then they had a couple sons. Their names were, you guys remember? Zip, zip, zip. Cain and Abel, all right?
Really close.
Cain and Abel. We're literally the second generation of people ever. And Cain murdered his brother in a field. It took one generation from the beginning of mankind for there to be a murder, a cold-blooded murder. And so we see that in Cain and Abel. In the Old Testament, there were wars, there were conflicts constantly. In Jesus' time, Jesus was crucified, but he wasn't the only one crucified. The Romans crucified people all the time. Who were the two guys that were next to Jesus on the cross? What were they? Thieves. These guys stole something, and they decided to literally inflict the most amount of pain you can inflict on someone. Crucifixion is known as one of the most painful ways to torture and kill someone ever. And these guys stole something, and that's what they got. Okay, these were violent cultures that these people were living in. So this isn't a 21st century problem, but it leads us to ask this question: does God even care about violence? Does God care about the violence that we are overexposed to? Does he care about things like what happened on Monday in Nashville? Does God even care? And we're going to get into this more, but I think the quick answer is yes. God cares. In Genesis 6, this is the story of Noah and the flood. Not too many generations after Cain and Abel, it says, "Now the earth was corrupt in God's sight, and the earth was filled with violence. And God saw the earth, and behold, it was corrupt, for all flesh had corrupted their way on earth. And God said to Noah, 'I have determined to make an end to all flesh, for the earth is filled with violence through them.'" Literally, the reason God sent the flood and wiped out generations of people in the Old Testament is because their culture was violent. God hates violence. Psalm 11:5 says that God's soul hates the one who loves violence. He cannot stand violence. And yet, we get to the New Testament, and we see how Jesus lived his life, and Jesus teaches us to respond to violence by turning the other cheek. He says, if someone slaps you on the cheek, turn the other cheek. And he models this when he's about to be arrested. A soldier comes and he's there to arrest him. Peter cuts his ear off and Jesus rebukes Peter, picks up his ear and heals the soldier. Jesus models this turn the other cheek mentality for us. And so I think that God cares, but I think that he has a way that he wants us to respond, a way that he wants us to live in a violent culture. And so we're going to be in Matthew 10.
So Matthew 10 says, "Behold, I am sending you out as sheep in the midst of wolves. So be wise as serpents and innocent as doves." And so, you know, this first part, Jesus acknowledges violence. And not only that, but he actually sends his disciples out into a violent culture, into a violent world, right? Yeah. He says that they are sheep among wolves. I'm not an animal expert, but sheep don't tend to do very well around wolves, I don't think.
No, they don't.
Yeah. So he knows that they're going out and there's a lot of violence. And so he's sending his disciples. So he acknowledges the violence, but he sends them towards that culture. But then he also gives them some advice, and he says to be wise and innocent. And so to use wisdom when you're in this culture, but then also have this pureness, this innocence, this thing that doesn't look like the culture of violence,
Yeah. This
innocence about you as you go.
Yeah.
And so he keeps saying, verse 17, "Beware of men, for they will deliver you over to the courts and flog you in their synagogues, and you will be dragged before governors and kings for my sake, to bear witness before them and the Gentiles."
I mean, right here, he gives them a promise. Like, he says, listen, beware of men. Like this is what's going to happen. You're going to go out, and there are going to be men who oppose you, violent men. And what they're going to do is they're going to deliver you over to the courts. They're going to arrest you, and they're going to beat you in front of other people. They're going to embarrass you. They're going to inflict violence upon you, and you're going to be asked to bear witness in front of other people in my name. Jesus here promises pain. He promised pain to the disciples. He told them he said, this is the culture that you're stepping into, and I promise you, there's going to be violence, and you're going to experience pain. It's a promise.
But then in his kindness, he doesn't just say that and leave it at that. But he talks about, he acknowledges what this might mean for them and the fear that they might have. And so he says, "When they deliver you over, do not be anxious how you are to speak or what you are to say, for what you are to say will be given to you in that hour. For it is not you who speak, but the Spirit of your Father speaking through you." And so here we see, like I said, that Jesus acknowledges the anxiety that is going to come with being in a violent culture. He knows that it's going to affect his disciples. He knows that it's going to affect you and me.
Yeah.
But he provides an answer for that. And his answer is to rely on the Spirit. Mm-hmm. His answer is to know that even in the midst of that, that God is, one, he is with you, but then two, he's going to give you what you need in those moments.
Yeah.
So then verse 21, "Brother will deliver brother over to death, and the father his child, and children will rise against their parents and have them put to death, and you will be hated by all for my name's sake. But the one who endures to the end will be saved. When they persecute you in one town, flee to the next."
I think this idea is interesting because I think the temptation for us, people who tend to over-exalt safety, right, is to read this last part and say, okay, when they persecute you, when you experience violence, you need to flee, you need to run, you need to go away, you need to shelter in place. But that's not the point that Jesus is making here. What he's telling them is, you're going to experience violence. I know that's going to make you anxious, but you need to rely on the Spirit. You need to step into those places. And if you experience persecution, flee to the next place and do it again. And if you experience it there, go to the next place and do it again. He wasn't saying hide, avoid it, run from it. What Jesus was saying is when you experience violence, and you will. When you have a time when you're in a risky situation, and you will be if you're following me. When you experience pain, and you will. Go to the next place and proclaim my name. Go be a light to the people. Jesus didn't ignore or avoid violence or suffering or pain. He actually allowed it to move him from a place of comfort toward compassion. Compassion for a culture that's violent. Compassion for people that are capable of great violence. And for us, I think that that is what Jesus is calling us to step into as well. He's trying to move us from this place of comfort and avoid pain at all cost to this place of compassion so that we can actually go love people and make a difference. And so I think that this is what he's moving us towards, but many times it's not what we do, is it? Many times it actually looks very different, and I think this is how it plays out in the world, and maybe this is how it's played out for you. This is a bit of a process that we walk through. So first, we have this exposure to violence, all right? Maybe it's by experience. Maybe you've witnessed violence in some way. Maybe you've scrolled past it on social media. Maybe you've just been around it. We're just in a culture that is violent, but we've all been exposed to violence in some way. And then the next step is, okay, we've been exposed to violence. We want to avoid harm. And that is a healthy thing. For your body is literally created like with a flight or fight response to danger, all right? You either fight it off or you get the heck out of there and you run and you avoid it. That is healthy. So we have this healthy idea of safety and this unhealthy idea of safety. A healthy idea of safety says maybe don't hang off a ledge, okay? Unhealthy idea of safety is we take it to the extreme and we say, I'm never going to a place that has ledges, right? You see how we get there? There's a healthy view of safety and an unhealthy view of safety. And so this is healthy. You're exposed to violence. You want to avoid harm. But then you kind of get to the next step and you avoid all risk altogether. You don't just avoid harm. You avoid anything that could potentially cause you pain. Anything. And so you take zero risks. You have no boldness about you. You don't go out and take steps that Jesus is calling you to take because you're afraid, because fear is dominating your life. You avoid all risk. And then what that leads to is this. You have a low tolerance for pain. You have this lack of resilience. You're not good at experiencing pain and fighting through it and pushing through it. I think it's a problem with not just your generation, but it is a problem in your generation. Is this, you've got to this point where there's a low tolerance for pain, and then inevitably what that leads to is when we experience pain, we have a low tolerance for it, and so it leads us towards anxiety and depression. We're not good at withstanding pain, and so we prescribe more anxiety medication than ever before. We prescribe more antidepressants than ever before. And then it doesn't always lead to this, but sometimes it takes another step and it leads towards things like self-harm. And so I want you to see what's happened here. In an attempt to stay safe and avoid harm at all costs, you've led yourself down a path that leads to self-harm, whether it's physical or just emotional. Violence against yourself. In the name of, I'm going to stay safe and comfortable, we've led ourselves towards more violence. It's a scary cycle to be in.
Yeah, and we want to take just a minute to give a little caveat here. If you have yourself experienced abuse or been a victim of violence, you might be thinking, he doesn't know what he's talking about. I do not have a low tolerance for pain. If you have gone through what I have gone through, you would know that. And we just want to say that we hear you and you're right.
Yes.
So for people who have been victims of abuse or a victim of violence, some of this does look the same, right? You've been exposed to violence and you do tend to want to avoid that. Like Alex said, this is a very natural response. You have that fight, flight, freeze response in yourself where you've got to do something, right? And so you do tend to start to avoid it, but it's not because you don't want that pain or you can't handle that pain. It's because every time that is triggered in you, you are re-experiencing the pain that happened to you. And so just to give a caveat there that for those of you who have been victims of violence, victims of abuse, your resilience is extremely high, and we want to make sure that you feel honored in that. that you do not have a low pain tolerance. This might look a little different for you. But also it does tend to end to the same place. We do see anxiety, depression, PTSD, self-harm. Some of these things still come out of being a victim, and that's kind of the same response there. And so we just wanted to take a moment just to make sure that we recognize maybe some of those of you in the room that that is your story. And just to say that you do have that resilience, but the effects of violence often still end up to be further violence in anxiety, depression, self-harm. And two, just to say, like, anxiety and depression is not a weakness. So don't think that if you struggle with anxiety or suffer from depression, it's because you can't handle pain the way you should be able to. In fact, these are common and natural responses of your body from that pain. So just to say that too, don't be like, oh man, I'm weak. I have anxiety, so I'm weak. That's not true, and we don't want you to hear us say that. So
Haley, what do we do from here? So that's kind of the question, right? Like, going back to our original question, how then do we actually take practical steps towards living in a violent culture?
Yeah, so I think the first thing that we have to do is we have to mourn what violence has done. We cannot ignore it. We cannot pretend it did not happen, it does not happen, or it will not happen. And so we need to take time to really mourn that. Violence has taken something from every single one of us. Whether that be, you know, I'm a mom of a toddler, and this shooting that just happened, like, that has taken my sense of safety in a sense of, like, is my kid going to be safe to go to school, right? So I've never personally, you know, been a victim of that violence, but it still took something from me. So for all of us, violence has taken something. If you are a abuse victim, violence maybe took your choice, or it took your trust in people. Maybe it took a family member. Maybe you were abused by a family member, and violence took someone that you love from you. And so we have to mourn what it has taken from us, but then also mourn what it has caused in us, whether that be anxiety, whether that be depression, PTSD, self-harm, whatever maybe is the result of that. We need to take time to really feel the effects of that, and just let it sink in. Like, this isn't fair. This isn't right. We need to take time to be sad. We need to take time to be mad. But even in that, we want to encourage you, don't run from the question, where is God? Because I think that we tend to do that. If we sit in that too long, if we sit in that mourning, sometimes we just want to ignore that God is even a factor in this. But we want to encourage you to run to that question, where is God in violence?
That's so helpful. So number two, not only do we need to mourn what violence has done, we need to make peace with God's role in violence. And this is really difficult, because as humans, we are a lot of times in our nature is in opposition with God's role in violence. We would do things differently than what he does. And so we ask the question, like, God, if you are all powerful, why are you not stopping this? God, if you can do anything, if you're omnipotent, why are you not putting an end to this? Why do these things keep on happening? And that's a difficult question to answer. People have been trying to answer that question since the beginning of time. It's called the problem of evil. And honestly, that it's a problem. Evil's a problem in this world. It's a result of sin. It's a result of brokenness. But we have to understand God's role in it. And I think what we think is, okay, how would we oppose violence? Well, we think the opposite of violence is safety and comfort. So I'm going to pursue safety and comfort. But God doesn't do that. God opposes violence with two things. He opposes it with peace and with justice. Not safety and comfort. He opposes it with peace and justice. And those things are hard for us to understand sometimes, especially the way that God chooses to do it.
Yeah, and so I think, you know, we do often think, well, if God allows violence, if God allows abuse, if God allows all of these things to happen, how can he also care about me? God can't care about me if he let all of these things happen to you or to me. And so I think, you know, we often ask that question. And like Alex said, it's because in our perspective, I can't tell you how many times after the stories that I hear doing the work I do that I have a conversation with God. And I'm like, hey, I would have done this differently. Like, I would have stopped this. I would have done something about it. And really been confused of why he didn't. But the thing is we tend to run to the things that we understand. And the reason we do that is because what we understand makes us comfortable. And so we feel comfortable with what we understand, and we feel uncomfortable with what we don't understand. But we aren't called to comfort, like we've said. And so I think just saying, like, we've got to trust God in what we don't understand. And we've got to trust that he gives peace in the moment, and he will give justice eternally and eventually. And so just trusting that in God and trusting his goodness even in an evil world. And I think I often say too, the only reason we know any of this is evil is because we know what good is, because God is good. If there was no good, there would be no evil. And so holding on to that God is good even when evil exists.
I think that kind of leads us to the third and final thing, which is we have to allow God to move us out of our comfort zone. We got to move out of our comfort zone, because following Jesus is controversial, right? It's costly. There's nothing costly about comfort. There's nothing controversial about living a comfortable life. And so that takes us right to our bottom line for tonight, which is this, that Jesus does not call you to comfort. He doesn't call you to comfort. And that's what we want. That's what deep down inside we want, to be comfortable. And that's not a bad craving, because one day in eternity, if you've given your life to Jesus, you're going to be in paradise and you're going to be very comfortable. You're not going to have a worry in the world. You're not going to have a pain in the world. There's going to be no more violent culture around you. You're going to be with Jesus, who is peace. Jesus, who has brought justice to the world. And you're going to be there, and it's going to be comfortable. But on this side of eternity, Jesus does not call you to live a comfortable life. He promises you that you're going to be in a culture that's violent. He promises you that you're going to experience pain. But he's given us his Spirit so that we can walk through that. And when you look at Jesus' life, his life wasn't comfortable. His life, like Landon said last week, his life led him to die on a cross. Paul's life was not comfortable. Peter's life was not comfortable. The disciples' lives weren't comfortable, and your life should not be comfortable either. God doesn't call us to that. He calls us to step into dark places and be the light, which kind of takes us to our last verse. I'm just going to read it. Our last verse keeps going, and he says, so have no fear of them, the people that are going to persecute you, the one that are going to take you into the synagogues and beat you and flog you. Have no fear of them, for nothing is covered that will not be revealed, or hidden that it will not be known. What I tell you in the dark, say in the light, and what you hear whispered, proclaim from the housetops. You see, God didn't call you to enter safe spaces. He called you to enter the dark places and be the light. He called you to enter dead places and bring the life that you have experienced in Jesus. God has called you not towards comfort. He's called you towards boldness, to live a controversial life. That's costly. There's nothing costly about living comfortably. So the answer to the question, how do I live in a violent culture, is not pursue safety at all costs. The answer is pursue peace and justice, which is found in Jesus, and pursue Jesus at all costs. That's the calling. Let me pray for us. Father, God, we thank you.